It's currently the day after the final episode of Better Call Saul ended here in the UK right now, and it's all I can think about. So I've decided, after watching the amazing finale, Saul Gone, yesterday, I thought I'd look at some hidden details and Easter eggs, because there were just so many in this episode that tied into previous bits in Better Call Saul, but also bits in Breaking Bad that we'd seen before as well. So I thought I'd do a little video on it, and yeah, if you've watched the finale, you can see if you've noticed these too.
Listen, you've got Agent Schrader's widow back there. Why don't you invite her in?
One that absolutely, I think, well, it spun me out, but definitely it seems a lot of Better Call Saul Twitter was spun out as well, is the introduction of Betsy Brandt, who plays Marie Schrader in Breaking Bad. It was almost as if Betsy's cameo was a bit of a jump scare for everyone. It was just her eyes piercing through the camera. That's how I felt, staring at Saul, you know, full of grief, full of anger, obviously a little bit of fear as well. She looked horrified, but it was just her eyes that were really, really powerful. And I feel like from when you cut from there to the bit where Saul is in the room and he can't stop looking at the one-way screen, I feel like their eyes were locked, you know, ever since that moment. And I think this is possibly one of the most twisted moments that we got of Saul's character. He was fully Saul. There wasn't a lot of Jimmy left. He was just really manipulative.
I was kneeling in front of an open grave with a gun pointed at my head. That was my introduction to Walter White.
And you think jurors are going to buy that?
One. All I need is one.
For me, that was the most hardcore Saul moment. We saw that. That sort of showed just how capable of criminal behaviour and violence it is. He's always been seen, obviously, as a bit of a gimmick, you know, in the bright suits or whatever, and he hasn't fully been violent, I guess, himself, I feel. It was that, and then we saw the shot with Carol Burnett when he had the telephone cord, and it looked like he was going to commit some sort of violent act. And it reminded me of Kim Wexler's lowest moment, that I felt the same level of uncomfortableness, is when they went to Howard Hamlin's memorial at HHM.
I didn't know what to do, so I just walked out. And the next morning when we saw each other, neither of us said anything about it. I never told anyone.
I also thought what was quite cool is that there's a bit of a parallel, I guess, between Saul giving that fake confession and Marie sat there with when Walt did that stupid confession video and gave his fake story about how Hank apparently had caused him to do all this stuff, and Marie was sat watching that too.
This is my confession.
So let's go back to the scene which includes Walter White in a flashback.
It's just a thought experiment. There's gotta be something you'd go back and change if you could.
I thought it had one of the most powerful lines spoken in it when they were talking about regrets, which seems to be a theme in all of these flashbacks.
So you were always like this.
But he did see himself as above Saul, even in that moment in the Hoover shop basement where they're both waiting to be relocated as completely different people because of their crimes.
How could you never tell me about this? We could have done something with this.
You'd have been the last lawyer I'd have gone to.
Throughout Saul's life, he does put himself out as Saul Goodman, a bit of a joke, but also the big suits, everything like that is a persona. But people do think, despite him managing to get people out of really tricky situations, and himself, he's a really clever guy. He's an excellent lawyer, but everyone around him sees him as a joke.
If you don't like where you're heading, there's no shame in going back and changing your path.
I think the flashback with Chuck is just before Better Call Saul starts, episode one.
I'll see you tomorrow, Chuck. And I might have the Financial Times.
Oh, Financial Times.
But it also seems like quite a new arrangement, because he does say, Jimmy, you know, I could get someone from the office to come and do this. Why are you doing this for me?
Because you're my brother. Duh. You'd do the same for me.
Chuck kind of looks at the floor, and it's a really interesting detail, because I thought it at the time, no, you wouldn't. Chuck wouldn't be doing this for you, Jimmy, at all. Even though you're brothers, you're the one that's looking after Chuck. It wouldn't be the other way around.
Well, you could stay for a while. We could talk.
He actually was quite sincere at this moment. He'd actually just like some company. He'd like to talk with his brother. And then in season one, episode one of the whole show, Jimmy is the one that says,
Chuck, can you not read that for a second? Can we talk?
It could have been a bit of a bonding moment. And there is a nod to Chuck further on in the episode, which was quite good. Better Call Saul has had so many good transitions. In this episode, after Chuck's flashback scene, we see him take his book off the side and walk off into another room. And you can see that the light, as that fades and then the new scene comes in, it cuts to being right on top of the prisoner bus that Jimmy is being transported in off to the prison. You could look at it as sort of light and darkness, a nice brotherly family maybe moment that could have happened that's now been travelled off into the distance. That time has passed, you know, that can't come back. The light fading on top of the prisoner bus, signifying, you know, dark and what has actually happened to Jimmy. It could also have signalled, you know, that light, that little bit of hope, you know, has faded away. Jimmy can't rectify himself now. He is just in prison, as we find out, for 86 years. It's gone. That moment is gone. But I thought it was also interesting that that lamp is what physically killed Chuck. He did sort of kick over that oil lamp and it set the whole house on fire. That's how he committed suicide. And it kind of is Chuck's downfall. This being in prison could be seen as Jimmy's downfall, his fate, if you will. It links them, so it could show that it was kind of always really about Chuck. Chuck was the catalyst. You know, maybe if Jimmy had spoken with him about their relationship, or they could have been better friends or whatever, because Jimmy was always seeking his approval, maybe things would have gone differently. The one I've seen everyone talk about is the book, H.G. Wells' The Time Machine. But we've also seen a copy of that book before in two other episodes. The first one is in the beginning of season 6, where Saul's house is getting completely gutted and taken away. And on one of the sides, you can see it right in the front of the frame. It is a little bit obscured because it is right at the front, sort of alarmingly. And then we cut later to the episode 602, and it's there on the nightstand in Jimmy's apartment. One thing to note is he never asked Kim. I don't know if there was just no time for them to really talk. He never asked Kim about a time machine. He didn't ask her about regrets. He never gave his own regrets when Mike asked him and Walt asked him. So it made you sort of think, did he not have a regret? Is there nowhere that he'd want to go back in a time machine? Is it something to do with Kim? Because obviously she's a huge focus in the episode and maybe it's left unspoken. But I think it does link back with Chuck.
I got his malpractice insurance canceled. I took away the one thing he lived for, the law. After that, he killed himself.
The lawyer sort of said, well, this isn't even a crime. Why did you start talking about that? And I think it's just because he couldn't keep that in. That was what was playing on his mind, you know, how Chuck ended up killing himself because he got his malpractice insurance canceled and it was his fault. I think that was Jimmy's regret.
There's some people I'd like to check on in 5 or 10 years. Make sure they're doing okay.
So let's look back at the first flashback that we see in this episode with Mike in the desert. I liked how they went back to that scene. I thought it was pretty good. You know, the two of them connected in a really weird circumstance. They've been walking for hours. It gave a little bit of a chance to have some vulnerability between the two, or for Mike to indulge Saul's silliness. And he does when he talks about the time machine. Mike gives two very specific dates, and that's so Mike of him. Very, very detailed oriented. But it also makes you think that those dates are so ingrained into him and lodged in his mind that they must be completely significant for some reason, and they have been playing over and over and over.
December 8, 2001.
We could kind of see that that was his son's death, because that's sort of just before this show started in 2002. So we could say, you know what, we understand why he's picked that date. That's when his son died.
No. March 17th, 1984. Day I took my first bribe.
It's interesting because there are a lot of players here in the Breaking Bad universe that are criminals. They've all got involved. They've chosen that life. But Mike, I feel like, is one of the only people that we see that genuinely regrets it.
There'll be justice.
And it kind of reminded me of that scene with Nacho's dad where they talk, you know, through the fence.
What you're talking about is not justice. What you talk of is revenge. Status del cartel y su justicia. Todos son iguales.
Mike feels like he's clearing his conscience coming to tell Nacho's father what happened to his son. You know, he didn't suffer and all that. But he can't actually lose his connection. So he says he'd like to go back because he regrets being involved in all of this. And if he hadn't have gone and taken up that bribe, his son would still be alive. He wouldn't have to be doing this stuff. Something that I've seen in a few interviews about the flashbacks, it kind of does mirror A Christmas Carol. You know, you've got three ghosts. They are three men who are dead, sort of coming back in the final episode to sort of haunt Jimmy and make him relive some of his past moments and change his life ultimately. And like Scrooge in A Christmas Carol, it leads him to a moment of reflection and then change. It kind of does that for Saul too, as he completely goes in a different direction.
It's showtime.
All rise. For the Right Honourable Judge Samantha Small.
First thing that we notice is that he's not Gene anymore. He is dressed in his Saul Goodman attire. The bit of detail that I thought was excellent is that he had a commemorative Wayfarer pin on it, a ribbon, which we see him wear throughout Breaking Bad after the Wayfarer plane crash. So I thought that was genius. It was like part of his uniform coming back, and it was one of those small details that for huge fans, you know, we would have sat there and gone, oh my god, that's from the Wayfarer. What I also really liked was the look that he gave walking down that corridor. It gave the same vibe of, you know, when action heroes walk straight slow motion in front of the camera and you've got a big burning building exploding behind you or something. It gave that sort of action hero look. He had that sort of smolder that he puts on, that he put on when we saw him completely transform into Saul after the moment that Kim broke up with him in the sixth season. As soon as he walks in, he's still got that smug look about him, but everyone is turning to look at him. They're all sort of rolling their eyes. You do have Marie sat there as well, and Steve Gomez's wife, and they're both like, oh, him, you know, look at him. He's so brazen, coming in that bright suit. They just think, oh, no. He is looking for one person only, and that is Kim. Has he managed to get Kim there? Because she is a big part of this plan. Even when he sits down, he kind of sits down to the side because he's already turning around looking to see if Kim is looking at him to catch her eye. So he has obviously decided he needs to get Kim there so she could see. She could see that he was going to be Jimmy again. But I also think that he wanted her there because he isn't sure whether he'd actually go through with it. He needed her there as a bit of conscience, because without her, we saw him go as Saul. He turned into Saul once she left. So to have her back, he actually committed to confessing. When he stopped looking at Kim in the courtroom and he turns to Oakley and says it's showtime, it's another mirroring moment, as we've seen him say that before. Another interesting detail that sort of makes you think back to the beginning of this season when they're clearing out Saul Goodman's house is the cardboard cutout of Saul they put in the bin. He stood there doing his signature, you know, finger guns. What I like about this is that obviously Saul Goodman himself was then found in the bin. You know, Gene has to pop his head out of the bin looking really sheepish, completely different to the guns image that he was pulling before.
I visited a client once at ADX Montrose. The Alcatraz of the Rockies.
After his speech in the courtroom, he says,
I'm James McGill.
Because he feels like, right, my conscience, it's now clear. I've owned up to everything. This is me. I'm Jimmy now. I'm not Saul. But then we cut to the scene of him on the prison bus.
Better call Saul.
The chanting in this scene kind of debunks any of the what's going to happen to Saul in prison. You know, is he going to get beaten up? Is he going to get attacked or whatever? It shows that actually he's going to be seen as a bit of a kingpin in prison because he's helped out so many of the prisoners and the criminals before.
You walk in with your head held high, you'll be the John Dillinger of the Metropolitan Detention Center. How bad is that?
He's been on their side and they sort of respect him. They see him as actually quite a great guy. So weirdly, it's a bit of a happy moment for Saul. It then cuts to a moment of a dough machine, mixing some dough, and you think, oh, Cinnabon, because we've had so many of those shots when Gene was working at Cinnabon in Omaha. But actually, no, that's what Jimmy's doing in the prison. He's using his baking skills that he picked up in Cinnabon, which is hilarious. And you hear the guard come in and say, Saul, your lawyer wants to see you. A prisoner comes around and says also the name Saul again. So you've had a few people say, Saul, Saul, Saul. You've heard the chant, Better Call Saul. And then he comes into the room where his lawyer is, and it cuts to Kim Wexler, and she's there and says, hi, Jimmy. We realise that Kim Wexler is literally the only person that sees Jimmy McGill, that sees that the youthful side, the more innocent side, the kinder side and emotional side of Saul Goodman. Kim is the only one that sees that.
Turns out my New Mexico bar card doesn't have an expiration date.
obviously, a lot of people have noticed that it is very reminiscent of the first time we see Kim. She is in the shadows of the parking lot downstairs at HHM, and Jimmy comes and joins her, and they both share a cigarette in the same way, and there is that instant connection between the two. Jimmy pulls out the cigarette from Kim's mouth, and they both share the same one. You can see that they're connected. And in this, despite the fact that they've been divorced, there is still that immediate connection, that intimacy between them. So it's quite a nice bookend moment, really. A lot of people online have liked this scene because it kind of shows Kim back to her old ways. We see in a few moments before she actually starts volunteering at a law office. She obviously starts answering the phone, but the scene that we see just before the courtroom scenes, she's still there in the dark. She's got lights on. It's like she's back at HHM as well in doc review or something. She's still working hard. So people have questioned whether Kim Wexler actually gets back into the law. I don't think she does, because this civil suit from Cheryl could come down at any moment and she wouldn't be able to practice that with all the allegations against her. But also I think people were asking this because her dress sense kind of changed a bit. She still has that really awful hair. I appreciate she's older and might want an older hairstyle, but she didn't have her signature ponytail. I wonder if that was a decision that they thought about, whether she was going to have her hair up in a ponytail again, just like the old Kim Wexler did when she went to see Jimmy. She comes in sort of a bit back to how she was, so I do wonder if she kept her life in Florida or if she moved back to New Mexico, something like that. But I can't really see the version of Kim that we saw in the prison going back to that sort of strange barbecuing Hawaiian shirt wearing guy that she was dating back in Florida.
File these tomorrow.
Have a nice life, Kim.
There was some debate, I think, in the editing room whether to have the scene after the smoking scene. The creators decided that it was possibly better to have Jimmy and Kim separated at the end rather than being left together. The creators originally did film Kim doing the finger guns back to Jimmy, but they didn't use that in the end. But you can see in the scene they might have used a shot from that, because Ray Seahorn still has her fingers like this, kind of down by her side, near her bag. So I don't know if that's intentional, that she did sort of a subtle finger gun movement, or that was kept in from a scene that they had and previously didn't use. But I just thought it was interesting. I like the idea that she sort of went back with the finger guns just subtly down next to her side, and he saw another bit of, you know, kind of intimacy. That connection was still going to be there. Maybe a signal that their relationship as friends or whatever was going to continue beyond this one visit. It maybe showed that they were connected and would be further into his 86-year sentence. Do they get back together? What happens to Kim? Does Cheryl take Kim for everything she's got? What ultimately happens in the end? Please let me know your theories in the comments, as I would really love to read them, because I'm not really sure what I think would have actually happened at the end. You know, I've said I'd like the Grease moment, you know, John Travolta and Olivia Newton-John flying off in the car. I'd like that for Jimmy and Kim, but you obviously can't do that when you've got a multitude of fences in between you and you're in prison for more than some people's lifetimes. Anyway, thanks for watching this video. My name's Gre-ea. I make videos here on YouTube all about TV shows and films. So if you love TV as much as I do, consider clicking the subscribe button, as you'll get a notification every time I upload a new video.